Tonight, we welcome those on live stream also. Many of you were at those meetings in Ohio, so we're rejoicing for you also. Amen. We'll be in John, the fourth chapter, verses 49 and 50. This will be our 55th exegesis of this book. Now, it's not possible to stress believing too much.
Amen.
I suppose it's partly owing to me approaching my departure, but I'm seeing this thing of faith more clearly, and how that we can't afford to be distracted from it to the problems of the day.
Yes,
amen. See, to career people, dealing with problems sounds smart. That's how they build their reputation and their constituency. But there's like nothing like this in the scripture. Just recently, a good brother, earnestly seeking the truth, asked me what the Bible says, or what is the proper approach of Christians to the political process. So I told him, well, the Bible doesn't say anything about this, because our kind of government isn't even recognized by God. A monarchy is the only kind of government he ever did recognize. It's the only kind that's in the Bible. So what the Bible does tell us about it is that we're to pay our taxes, give honor to the king, do what's good. That's your involvement. So far as the scriptures are concerned, that's your involvement with the political process. So he felt that way anyway himself. But you see, this whole thing has created a whole bunch of problems that are not in the scripture. We've been given the right to vote, blah, blah, blah. Well, but the majority of voters have never changed the tide. It's always overridden by another process. But at any rate, I don't like to dwell on that. My point is that faith is an X in the scripture. Now, flesh cannot take advantage of faith. Can't exploit it. Even though many think it's possible. Now remember, believing is what faith does. See, faith is the noun and believing is the verb. I know you know that, but some people make a distinction between the two. It's not. Faith always believes.
Amen.
The reason you can't exploit faith is because the association the Spirit makes with faith is beyond this present evil world. Matter of fact, there are things that the person who's of the world doesn't even have an interest in the things that are by faith. Some people want evidence, see, but faith is evidence.
Amen.
That's why you got to examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. Mm-hmm. You have to know yourself whether you believe or not.
Yeah.
Don't take that for granted.
Yeah.
Don't take that for granted.
Mm-hmm.
Confirm that you do, in fact, believe. If you do, that's evidence.
Yeah.
You don't have to have anybody else prove the reality of what God talks about. If you believe, that's the evidence.
Mm-hmm.
Someone may dig up a skull someplace out the east. That's not going to do anything at all for faith.
Amen.
It'll make men famous, but it won't make for faith. Faith is substance and evidence. That's the King James Version. It's New American Standard says assurance and conviction. The NIV says being sure of or certain of. See, and those are all things people that are serious want. They want that.
Yes.
But faith is the thing that brings it to them. See, substance, evidence, assurance, conviction, these are not philosophical terms. These are terms of reality.
Amen.
The only people that philosophize are people that don't know.
Yeah.
Hmm? That's why they philosophize. When it comes to the things of God, they're proclaimed.
Yes.
Amen.
Not philosophized. You don't have to produce any reasons for God saying what he said. You don't have to do it. In fact, how would you do it?
Yeah,
be quite a challenge, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Faith settles the heart, see?
Yes.
Because they're just by virtue of being in the world, we're all subject to being troubled.
Yes.
And being agitated. But faith settles that down, settles your heart down. And we must remember, too, that faith can't produce bad fruit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen. You can't do it. It's a good tree. Faith's a good tree. The bad tree is unbelief. Now, it produces bad fruit. When James says, and how well I remember using this argument when I was young and ignorant. Thank God I've been old and ignorant. That's worse yet. He says, faith without works is dead also, or the King James says, being alone. Mm-hmm. Now, James isn't saying there's such a thing as dead faith.
That's right.
Uh-huh. Although there are people that say it, there is.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Uh-huh.
I was taught this personally. There's no more dead faith than there is a person that is a corpse. That's James' point. A corpse is not a person.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And faith without works is not faith.
That's right.
That's the point he's making.
Yeah, amen.
Revolutionary when you see it. There's no such thing as faith that doesn't work. There's no such thing.
That's right.
Just
amen.
As there's no such thing as a corpse that has a spirit.
Yeah. Yeah.
No such thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I praise the Lord for deliverance from that sterile way of thinking. Now, believing is also always associated with doing something. If thou canst believe, all things are possible. See, that's something that's done. All things are possible to him that believes. See, this is the context of doing something. Who is he that overcomes the world? Or he that believes.
Yeah,
see,
right.
That Jesus is Christ is the Son of God. So faith is always associated with doing something, not thinking something,
mm-hmm.
doing something or being something. Now our text will confirm the power of believing,
mm-hmm.
the sheer power of believing.
Yeah.
John 4:49-50. The nobleman saith unto him, Sir, come down ere my child die. Jesus saith unto him, Go thy way, thy son liveth. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, this man had come to Jesus, hearing that he was in that area. And he said to ask Jesus to come and heal his son,
mm-hmm.
who was at the point of death. And Jesus said, Except ye see signs and wonders, you'll not believe. Now, there were those standing there at the time that did apply to.
Mm-hmm.
But it didn't apply to the nobleman.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he knew it didn't. He didn't even bother dealing with that because that didn't apply to him. See, there's things addressed to unbelievers. Those are not things you say to believers. Now, a lot of preachers haven't learned this. They really haven't learned this. They're continually saying to believers what ought to be said to unbelievers.
Yeah.
And they're saying to unbelievers what's only intended for believers. Blessed is the person who knows the difference. So this man just pretty much ignores what was said because he wasn't in that category. He wasn't asking Jesus to do something to prove Jesus was the Christ.
Right.
He was asking something because he is already convinced Jesus was the Christ.
Yeah.
See, there's a difference
yes.
now. There's a difference in asking God to do something to prove that he is who he says he is, and asking him because you know he is who he says he is. See, those who truly believe will not devote themselves to pondering what's said to unbelievers. They're warned about unbelief, but what's said of unbelievers isn't said to believers. The believer knows intuitively that faith is never rebuked. Even a believer may not be able to explain that to somebody, but he knows it intuitively. He knows that I'm not going to be rebuked by God for believing. God's looking for faith. He's not going to rebuke it when he finds it. And if there's a person whose faith is weak, maybe your faith is weak. You wish it was stronger. And you do what this father of this possessed son did after Jesus had been transfigured. You know, he come down the mountain here. This is trouble was brewing down here. A man had brought his son to the disciples to cast the devil, demon out of him, and the disciples couldn't do it. Nine of them collectively couldn't do it. And this man said to Jesus, if you can do anything, help us. Jesus said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. And the man said, Lord, I do believe. Help my unbelief. All right, if you got things you're praying about, nothing's happening, and you wonder, ask God to help your unbelief. Because if you can believe, there isn't anything that's not possible.
Amen.
That's what Jesus said.
Yes. That's right.
You can theorize about it all you want, but say, help my unbelief.
Yeah.
Amen. That's what to do. We know from the testimony of the Holy Spirit that wavering voids your request. Even if it's a request for, like, wisdom. If a person wavers, it cancels out.
Yeah.
The prayer was wasted time. Here's how it's put in Scripture. Talking about asking for wisdom. Let him ask in faith, nothing wavering.
Yeah.
He that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think he shall receive anything from the Lord. Now, wavering means doubting. And a later version say that. Let him ask without no doubting, without any doubting, must believe and not doubt, never doubting. See, doubting. Will he really? Is God really able to do this? Will he do this? That's doubting.
That's right.
It voids the request. That's why this man prayed, help thou my unbelief. See, that's why he knew that. He knew that. Now, I tell you right now, this is not being commonly taught.
Yeah.
I won't say it's not taught at all, because some places I'm not familiar with, but surely someone is teaching this. But unanswered prayers can only be traced to a couple of things. They were asked amiss.
Right?
That's one. And they doubted when they asked. I think those are the only two.
It's actually being taught that God understands that he knows that we all doubt. That's what I've heard. That God understands and he knows that we all have doubt, but he's able to work with doubt. This says he's not able.
He's not able. He will not.
Yeah.
He will not. He will not. Now this confirms to us that an unwavering and strong faith, I hear what I'm saying, does not require a lot of teaching. I wanted to say a few words about this, or a special course or a catechism. At the very best, this nobleman could not have been subjected to much teaching about faith. At the very best. I mean, until John the Baptist, there hadn't been hardly any. There hadn't been any. Moses didn't teach about faith. The law was not of faith. The law didn't require faith. The prophets didn't say much about faith. For instance, in all the writings of Moses, faith is mentioned one time. And it's they had no faith. That's how it's mentioned. And in the prophets, it's only mentioned one time in the King James Version. The just shall live by faith. That's it. That's all.
Yeah.
See, if you want to read about faith, Solomon talked a lot about trust.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's an aspect of faith, but faith is bigger than
yes.
is bigger than trust.
Mm-hmm.
My point here is it doesn't take a lot of time or teaching to enable a person to believe. That's my point.
Mm-hmm.
This man, he'd have jumped for joy if he'd heard some of the things we heard just last week. Not to mention a whole lifetime. God will enable a sensitive heart to believe, just like he did the Thessalonians. They only had 3 weeks.
Hmm? That's right.
There isn't any teaching course that doesn't last more than 3 weeks. And some of them last 15 weeks. Three Sabbaths, to be exact. It wasn't 3 full weeks. It was 3 Sabbath days. 3 Sabbath days. They had no exposure before other than at synagogues. And after 3 Sabbath days, the Thessalonians believed.
Yeah, amen.
See? Yes. Well, it doesn't take, my point is, it doesn't take a lot. It just takes the right message.
Yeah, right. Yeah,
see,
amen.
Faith comes from God.
Amen.
It yes. comes by hearing. And hearing also comes.
Mm-hmm.
Faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes. By the word of God, but God, that it's through the gospel, which is the
yes.
power of God and salvation. There's something to be said. The woman with an issue of blood, I don't know how much she knew. If you were to ask her to comment, you know, about all she could tell you is that Jesus is able. I would imagine that. He's the Messiah. But you couldn't stop her from getting to Jesus. You
yeah.
couldn't stop her. She was weak.
Yeah.
There was a crowd. She pressed. She had to, I assume she was like crawling, but she had to press through this crowd in an infirm condition, but she had faith.
Yeah.
You know, the scriptures tell us that the just will live by faith. That's the thing that motivates them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's something I think to be said here about dealing with infirmities. Now, this is my own persuasion that God isn't going to do for you what somebody else can do. What, I mean, how would you glorify him? Would you glorify him for doing what somebody else can do? What distinguishes him? I'm just talking about my own view here. Take, for instance, some weaknesses, some illnesses. The woman with the issue of blood, she tried the physician. The
yes.
physicians couldn't help her.
That's right.
Now, Timothy, he was sickly.
Mm-hmm.
Some people don't want you to know this, but this is the truth.
Right.
Timothy was sickly.
Mm-hmm.
We'd say, my grandma used to say, puny. And here's what Paul wrote to him. This is taken from the NIV. Stop drinking only water. Whoa, boy, the health experts would be loony after he said that, huh?
Yeah.
Huh? This would not go over today.
Oh, yeah.
Stop drinking only water and use a little wine because of your stomach and frequent illnesses. When the poor saints in Jerusalem, there was a famine there.
Uh-huh.
The poor saints didn't have food. The apostles didn't say, pray that God will send you food.
Yeah.
Eh? Instead, he told the saints, you send them some food.
Yeah,
remember?
Yeah.
See, there are conditions that cannot be resolved by men or nature. There's some things you can't grow out of. Like there are some diseases, if you wait long enough, they'll just go away. There's some conditions that people can help. There's some they can't. The widow learned the hard way. I once learned that about members of my family were something that they couldn't do anything about it. We resorted to the Lord. It was the Lord's will, was take them. So he did. Now you'll remember that Jesus taught people about persistence. We're seeing this in this man here. He presses into Jesus. Jesus throws up this temporary barricade. Except you see signs and wonders, you'll not believe. He presses. He presses through it. He's not deterred by that at all.
That's right.
Yeah. Sir, he says, come down.
Yeah.
You remember Jesus taught us about this persistence. He talked about a widow lady that went to an unjust judge who didn't regard God or man, and she pleaded, avenge me, my adversary. Stop this adversary from persecuting me. And the judge didn't pay attention to her. But she kept on. She wouldn't let up. Avenge me, she said, avenge me, my adversary. And Jesus has given this parable. He says, after a while, the unjust said, because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me.
Yeah.
Then Jesus said, hear what the unjust judge saith. And shall not God avenge?
Yeah.
That's the word.
Uh-huh.
That's the word now.
See,
you can't avenge yourself. You're forbidden to avenge yourself.
Amen.
But vengeance is coming.
Amen.
Nobody
uh-huh.
who has made it difficult for you, this will not be overlooked by God.
Right.
You'll either convert him or he'll damn him. One or the other. But he will not overlook it. How much more will God avenge his elect, his own elect,
yeah.
who cry out day and night? Unto him, though he bear long with them. I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? That's this kind of faith. Will he find a persevering, a pressing, moving into the Lord, not quitting? Will he find that kind of faith on the earth? Now tonight, you determine that by God's grace, he'll find it in you.
Amen. Yes.
Will he find people giving up or pressing in? Will he find people quitting or pressing? Which one will he find?
Yeah.
Well, this nobleman here, he was pressing.
Yes, amen.
Remember those four men that brought a sick man to Jesus?
Yeah.
Paralyzed man.
Uh-huh.
When they got there, the house is surrounded by people, they couldn't get in.
Uh-huh.
Now, these four men didn't say, this must be the wrong time, we'll come back tomorrow. See, we're talking about faith now, see.
That's right.
When they could not come in nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was, and when they had broken it up, they let the man in the bed down wherein the sick of palsy lay.
Yeah.
Now, what did it say Jesus saw? He saw their faith.
Amen.
Not the faith of the man,
yeah.
saw there. He saw.
Yes.
He sees yours too.
Amen.
Now in a Christian world that's largely academic, this all sounds kind of impractical.
Uh-huh.
Men would rather be moved by what they see.
Uh-huh.
Men of faith are moved by what they hear.
Uh-huh. Yes. Amen.
That's why it's important. What we say up here is important. Got to be food for faith. None of us can confer faith on another person. We can't do it. And what's more, none of us will live very long before we will confront something that nobody on earth can do anything about. Now, you won't live probably not another day until you'll face something like this that nobody else can really help.
Yeah.
Don't give up.
Amen.
Don't gripe.
Yes. Yes.
And murmur. Be strong in faith, giving glory to God, like Abraham was. I've a few days, I'll be 80 years old. I still have to be reminded of this every day.
Uh-huh.
Be strong in faith, giving.
Amen.
Be not faithless, but believing. Don't quit.
Yes.
Don't give up. I know you don't feel good, but keep it going.
Amen.
You never outlive this.
Yeah,
as long as you're in the body. You never outlive this. But that's good. That's good news, because otherwise you could be discouraged. Yes, Brother?
I wanted to go back to what you said earlier about faith and teaching. And it might have sounded a little strange to some. You said that faith doesn't need a lot of teaching, but here we do a lot of teaching.
That's right.
And John said in 1 John 2, it says the anointing teaches you.
That's right.
He said, you have no need that I teach you anything.
Mm-hmm.
And a peculiar thing about that is he was teaching them when he said that.
That's right.
That you have no need that I teach you anything.
Uh-huh.
So I think what can be said about all of this is that faith doesn't require the jots and the tittles,
mm-hmm.
or the dotting of the I's and the crossing of the
yeah.
T's.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, faith doesn't have to be baby,
mm-hmm.
or spoon-fed.
Yeah.
And so when you said that faith doesn't have to have a lot of teaching, you haven't nullified the need for teaching.
Oh, no, that's initial faith we're talking about.
Right. Well, and you're talking about the nature of faith
yeah.
as well. In
mm-hmm.
And that's exemplified in this seeking,
mm-hmm.
and
that's
in this
right.
in this pressing forward.
Yeah.
So
mm-hmm.
there is a need for teaching.
Oh, yes.
But it's not the kind of teaching that says, now turn this way, now turn that way,
yeah.
now stand up, now sit down.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
I should have made that little clear. This is initial faith, because that's to begin believing.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to have this.
Mm-hmm.
But to increase in faith,
yeah.
you do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Jesus saith unto him, he said, sir,
yeah.
come down ere my child die.
Yeah.
This is Jesus' response.
Mm-hmm.
Go thy way, thy son liveth.
Uh-huh.
He immediately responds
yeah.
to the nobleman's faith.
Mm-hmm.
See, when he comes, he's going to look for faith. When the Son of Man comes, he looked for faith. He looked for it here and he found it, so he... Jesus always responds to faith. There's always a favorable response
yes.
to faith in heaven.
Amen.
Heaven never balks at faith.
Amen.
If there's faith, heaven doesn't look for a lot of other things, because faith produces a lot of other things. See, that's why it's sufficient. When Jesus went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, he was always on the outlook for faith, and when he comes a second time, he's going to be looking for faith. It's the nature of the Lord to look. Now, some people have trouble blending this with the sovereignty of God, and God knows all things. All of that is true. But this is an additional aspect of God, because if it wasn't this way, he wouldn't get glory by working in men.
Yeah,
see?
Right.
So the eyes of the Lord run to and fro upon the face of the whole earth to show himself strong in the behalf of those whose heart's perfect toward him. So he's looking for
yes.
somebody. One version reads, whose cause he can undergird.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Somebody who's doing something
uh-huh.
that requires God's support.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
He's looking.
Amen.
His eyes running to and fro. Again, in Ezekiel 22:30, he said, I sought for a man among them that would make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it. He didn't find any. You believe that a man could keep a land from being destroyed? Huh?
What is it?
That's what it says.
Yeah.
See, you don't have to rally a group of people. God's looking for a person.
Yeah.
He'll save a whole city if Abraham can ask within the framework of his will.
Yeah.
Amen.
That's how God is.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
So how important is it that we ask?
That's right.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. This is where teaching and edification and all this is necessary, because it develops in people a proper mindset.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this, the approach of law is, you better do it, see?
Yeah.
But if you teach people proper, the Lord will make that request of them, not verbally, but internally.
Yeah.
You should do this. See, the, that's the difference.
Amen.
Another time the Lord said, I sought for a man who would make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me, that I would not destroy the land.
Yeah.
And again through Jeremiah, he said, run, run, run. Run ye to and fro through the streets of Jerusalem and see now and know and seek in the broad places thereof. If you can find a man, if there be any that executeth judgment, that seeketh the truth, and I'll pardon it. Pardon the whole city.
Uh-huh. Amen.
I'll pardon the whole city.
Yeah.
If you can find a person, just an individual person, that executes judgment and seeks the truth, and I'll spare the city.
Yeah.
Oh, that's God, boy. You, we,
yes.
You can ask God to help you be that kind of person.
Yeah.
Amen. Jeremiah was not enough.
Yeah.
But he was such a man.
Yes, he was. Yes, he was.
But the sentence was already upon the city.
Yeah.
Yeah, you run. Mm-hmm. It was after that. He couldn't find any, and God couldn't either.
Yeah.
But that's the heart of God. God would have saved it
if
they could have found that kind of man.
Amen. You know, I tell you,
we brought this point up along here over some period of time now, but it's really growing on me with the way the nature of the Lord is, how he's looking for someone
that
he can do something.
That's right.
Because, you know, God wants to do something good.
That's right.
And I thought, you know, in your family, you know, if you got a righteous representative in your family.
That's right.
Or you've got one in the city or in the community.
Yeah.
And, but this is commonly not, this is not known. I've never heard this very much, if I heard it at all. But this is growing on me. How this rallies your hope.
Yeah.
You know, to be that
yeah.
person, and you know, so that God can do something.
Amen.
Yeah, I believe I've experienced some of this, and I know other people have too. There were people that we come to know now in Pakistan, Burkina Faso, India, Ghana, that were reaching out. They wanted something from God. This situation had existed for decades, maybe even centuries in some places. But it needed somebody in the world that was willing to do this outside the circumference of institutionalism and other constraints. Now, I know I'm a person he found. There's others, too. I'm not the only one. There's others that were not being received where they were. Like Jeremiah wasn't received where he was,
uh-huh.
but look how he's been received now.
Yeah. Amen.
If he'd held his peace. Anyway, it's something to really think about.
Yeah.
Don't. See, there are people that will want you to limit your thinking to your family or your city or your surroundings. Don't do that.
Yeah.
This world's bigger than your family.
Amen.
If you're not having success there, broaden the horizon out. Reach out someplace else. Do it.
Yeah.
Maybe maybe someone out there will reach your family if you need to reach them. But anyway, this is God. God has revealed this is the way he is. We have a parallel of this, God using somebody to help somebody else. John teaches it in 1 John 5:16. We've mentioned this quite frequently. If any man, how's that? Any man, anybody we'd say. If any man see his brother, fellow Christian, sin a sin which is not unto death, that is, death is not the consequence of the sin, like it was with Judas, Ananias, and Sapphira.
Right.
He shall ask, and he, God, shall give him, person of sin, life for them that sin not unto death.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. God can give people life who don't have spiritual life because you asked.
Amen.
Hmm? That's what he said.
Yeah.
Because you asked. Mm-hmm. Of course, I always, if you understand, this is someone who's walking in the light as he is in the light. This is not someone disinterested in themselves. They need prayer. Mm-hmm. You can enlarge your ministry quite a bit. Just by this. Remember, Abraham said, will you destroy the righteous with the wicked?
Yeah.
That's pretty bold. This is where he's asking God now.
Yeah.
Will you destroy the righteous with the wicked?
Yeah.
Now, he knows his nephew is living in Sodom.
Mm-hmm.
So he reasons with him, works his way down from 50 all the way down to 10.
Yeah.
God told him, if I can find 10, I won't destroy the city.
Yeah.
He didn't find 10.
Mm-hmm.
But he did find one.
Yeah.
He still destroyed the city, but he got Lot out because
mm-hmm.
Abraham prayed.
Amen.
That's because Abraham prayed.
That's right.
And he didn't destroy because it says Lot was a righteous man and vexed his righteous soul.
Yeah.
He was a righteous man. God didn't destroy. Huh?
That's right.
He didn't destroy the righteous with the wicked.
Yeah.
Abraham sensed he wouldn't,
mm-hmm.
but he pursued that. See, God uses people. In our text now, he's used a father to heal his son. The point is that intercession is an activity that's ordained by God.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus intercedes for us. We intercede for people. Paul said, I exhort, first of all, that prayers and intercessions be made for all men.
Mm-hmm.
And he was talking about when the assembly gathers.
Mm-hmm.
Prayers and intercessions, even through in kings and governors, even through those in there, for all men, intercessions. Why? Because this is what God's looking for. See, God's looking for someone that'll stand in the gap.
Yes.
That'll
yes.
stand up and intercede for people that are living in darkness and blindness and don't know where they're at.
Yeah.
And maybe they've been talked to, but they can't see. So this is stage two.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
This is stage two. So we have this father interceding for his son.
Yeah.
So Jesus says to him, well, go thy way. Go thy way. You can go now, go home now. That's equivalent to say, I've heard your request. That's equivalent to saying it. Go your way now. You remember when Jesus was speaking like God did to Abraham. Jesus was here speaking like God did to Abraham. He said to Abraham, Genesis 17:20, I have heard thee.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, if you ever experience this, and I have. It's not an everyday experience. But when you sense God says, I've heard you on this, you don't have to say anymore. You don't have to say anymore, I've heard you on this. See? When you hear that, no further petition is necessary.
Yeah.
Hezekiah, when Hezekiah prayed mm-hmm. for the Lord to give him mercy, he says, I've heard thy prayer.
Yeah.
When Solomon prayed for wisdom, God said, I've heard your prayer. When Samuel cried unto the Lord for Israel, 1 Samuel 7:9 says, the Lord heard him.
Mm-hmm.
When Elijah prayed God would let the soul of a dead child enter into him again, quote, the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came into him and revived him. The sweet psalmist of Israel, he had a testimony. He said, this poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and delivered and saved him out of all his trouble.
Yeah.
See, God hears intercession. Yes.
Daniel, when he was praying at the end of the 70 years, he was answered right in the middle of his prayer.
That's right.
And the angel Gabriel told him, as soon as you were making supplications, the command went forth.
That's right.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And he again was praying but for somebody else.
Yeah, yeah.
He himself never did get to leave Babylon.
Mm-hmm.
Eh?
Yeah.
go thy way. That's all the works. You don't have to carry this on anymore. No further prayer is needed. No further request is required. That's all in that word, go thy way. Thy son liveth. That is, he's not going to die as it looked like he was going to die. He was at the point of death when he came. The son was at the point of death, and Jesus aborted that process with his word. He said, go thy way, thy son liveth. He won't die. Now, no human reasoning could conclude that. Only faith could believe that.
That's right.
Man doesn't have the capacity to accept a word like that without doubting. He can't do it.
When so many of this kind of thing happens in the hospitals, they'll say, well, it was just a misdiagnosis.
Yeah,
that's all it was. Somebody prayed. Somebody asked, and God did something.
It's only been in recent years that I've seen that. That it's the wrong diagnosis. No, it wasn't.
Yeah.
Technology is too advanced.
That's right.
But it's treated that way. So thank God they read the chart wrong. You know. Well, I don't want to accept that. I don't question that's possible, but. Mm-hmm. When you're dealing with prayer, give the glory to God.
Amen.
Be like Abraham. He didn't look like a candidate for fatherhood, to say the least. Mm-hmm. It was a bit late for him and Sarah to start planning a family. But God told him he is going to have a son through Sarah. Instead of Abraham, who against hope, that is, it was contrary to, who against hope believed in hope, that's in hope he believed, that he might become the father of many nations according to that which was spoken. That's what was done. We're talking here about something Jesus said, not something he did, something he said. So with Abraham, according to what he has spoken, so shall thy seed be. Being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body, now dead, as far as reproduction is concerned, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. See, that's what real faith does. I've thought a lot about this, and throughout my early years, I don't remember hearing very much at all about God doing the impossible. I've searched. I can't tell you how much preaching and teaching I've been subjected to. It's staggering. You're way up in the tens of thousands, you know, in my life. But I don't remember hearing very much at all ever said about God doing the impossible. So the result of this is that I didn't think about like God doing the impossible. This wasn't, if someone was to ask me, can God do something that's impossible, I would have said, well, yes. But I'm saying this was not my thinking processes. This is not the way I thought. I thought in terms of rush to the doctor. This is how I thought. And I come to think, wait a minute, before we go to the doctor.
Yeah.
And we've had cases where we didn't have to then go. We had others we did have to go. So you can't lock into what the results are going to be. But it's necessary to keep before people all the time, there is no restraint with God to save with many or few.
Yeah.
See, that's got to be brought before people. With God, all things are possible. Nothing is impossible with God.
Mm-hmm.
All things are possible to him that believes. I want a steady diet of hearing that.
Yeah,
we need that.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Faith isn't staggered with seeming impossibilities. It's like a hurdle. It just leaps.
Mm-hmm.
Just leaps over that hurdle that other people's, it blocks them.
That's right.
Now, the test here is whether or not the nobleman can believe what Jesus has said. Mm-hmm. Thy son, three words. Thy son liveth. All right, let's see. Can the nobleman proceed on the strength of those three words? And the man believed the word. See, this is how potent faith is. This is how potent faith is. He believed the word that he had spoken and went his way. The Holy Spirit reports the response of this nobleman in words that people without faith can't comprehend. But people that have faith do. They know. They can remember specific times when they recalled a word God said and they believed it. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. I can remember when I believe that. I will lead you. My sheep hear my voice, they follow me. I remember when I believed that. See? And you have kindred experiences, I know. Now this believing is not done with the mind. It's done with the heart. This is expressly stated Romans 10:10, with the heart, man believes. The mind's involved, but the heart's deeper. It has a wider circumference than the mind has. The heart goes deeper than the mind goes. There's more of you in your heart than there is in your mind.
Yeah, amen.
See?
Yeah.
So deep down, he's convinced, in other words. He was convinced. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. So he's convinced.
Yes.
He goes on his way. Well, he came to Jesus weary and heavy laden, and he got some rest, and he headed back home.
Yeah.
Now, there's a considerable said about believing God in Scripture. Daniel said of Daniel, he believed in his God. That's what the king said about him after he'd been delivered. He believed in his God.
Yeah.
That was Darius's conclusion.
Yes. Yep.
He believed in his God. How did he know? Those hungry lions were just resting by the side of Daniel.
Yeah.
Concerning the resurrection of Christ, which he had often spoken of to his disciples, it confused them. What did he mean, rise from the dead? That's what they said when he was here with them. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this unto them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. See, there come a time when.
Yeah.
That's why it's important to speak the truth at all times. Speak the truth. See, we're not paying attention. Speak the truth.
Yeah. Amen.
Doesn't make any difference whether they're listening or not.
Yeah.
Speak the truth.
Right.
They didn't believe it when Jesus said it to them. They didn't confuse them. When he rose from the dead, they said, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. They believed the scripture and what Jesus said.
And the angel said, he is risen just as he said.
Just as he said. Amen. At the beginning of the church, it said that those who heard the apostles preaching, it is said, many of them which heard the word believed. And the number of the men was about 5,000. Oh, that's something. So believing can be synchronized in a number.
Amen.
Number of people. This is the kind of the secret to kingdom power is when a lot of people believe at the same time. And that's possible. Instead of the city of Samaria, they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus. They believe. I'm pointing out here, and in all of these, this is the first time. This first time they heard it, they believed. When certain were scattered by the persecution of Jerusalem, they preached in Antioch, and the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed,
yes,
and turned to the Lord because of what was said, not because of what was done,
yeah,
because of what was said. Paul and Barnabas preached in a synagogue in Iconium. a great multitude, both of Jews and also of Greeks, believed. Mm-hmm. See? Paul and Silas preached in the synagogue of Thessalonica. It says, some of them believed. When Paul was a prisoner in Rome, in his own rented house, he taught the people, and some believed the things which were spoken, and some believed not.
Yeah.
Now, my point here is that God has ordained to the foolishness of preaching to save them to believe. Mm-hmm. This is something that, I have to be careful how I say this, but helping people and assisting people is good, but that's not what moves them to believe.
Yeah, that's right.
People will not become Christians because you mowed their yard.
Yeah, that's right.
That doesn't mean don't mow their yard. Uh-huh. That doesn't mean that. But that means you're going to have to do more than that.
Yeah.
If you want them to believe, you're going to have to do more than that.
Uh-huh. Well, the multitude ate
the bread and the fish did not believe.
That's right. Exactly.
That's right. That's right.
He did feed them.
Bring them to faith.
Mm-hmm. He did feed them. Then when he began to speak to them, they didn't believe what he said.
Right,
now, what I'm endeavoring to show here is the high estimation heaven has when people believe the Word of God. How high this ranks. These days, I'm persuaded enough's not being said about this. In fact, people kind of draw back from faith. I remember when I was a novice, just kind of getting my feet on the ground. I was in Bible college. That's where you learn it all, you know. And I remember my father always emphasized faith.
Yeah.
And after I was subjected to Bible college, my dad sounded strange. I'm kind of ashamed to say it now, but that's the truth. That's it. Because he talked about faith all the time. He talked about faith. Wherever you went with him, you're talking about faith. He still, to the day he died, he was that way. Always talking about faith. Faith. And it dawned on me some years later when I was delivered from that environment. He was right. The stress is on faith, because everything you have by faith.
Amen.
You're children of God by faith. You're kept by the power of God through faith. See? You wait for the promise of the Spirit through faith. See? You wait for the hope of righteousness through faith. It's all through faith. That's why every time in Scripture faith services, God works.
Yeah.
If you're a Bible person, you'll find that to be true. God always works where there's faith. Abraham believed he would bear a son through Sarah.
Mm-hmm.
He could no more prove that to a physician. He couldn't prove that to a physician.
Mm-hmm.
You could have examined, if they had the ability to do so, examine his potential of becoming a father, and you could not prove. In fact, all the evidence would point another way. But Abraham believed. That's right.
He's losing his grip on reality.
And Sarah, by faith, received strength
to
conceive seed. Just how potent faith is, see? You've got things, no doubt, that you're dealing with in others or family or something that looks impossible.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, you've got to think of yourself like an impotent Abraham or a barren Sarah. And say, with God, all things are possible.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yes.
We can take a step backwards from your statement there and say that the fact that faith did surface was the beginning of that work of God.
That's right. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Really good. Would you say that faith is an enabler? I'm thinking of the man who was lame and or crippled, couldn't walk. Jesus says, get up, take your bed, and walk. when the man put forth the effort to do what Jesus said,
yeah,
was when he received power to do so.
That's right.
So on some level, that man believed that what this man is telling me, I can do.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's a sense in which this is true. What you have to guard against is that God is the enabler. God uses faith.
Right.
Without God, faith falls to the ground. But there is a sense, I understand what you're saying, there is a sense in which this is true. But it's because faith is tied,
yes,
because God honors the...
We're not talking about faith and faith.
Pardon?
We're not talking about faith and faith.
Yeah.
Many do.
Sometimes we just said things that just said clumsily. I know that's, you don't mean that we have faith and faith, but there are some people that do think that. Yes.
There's a modern phrase that for some reason doesn't gel with me, and I thought maybe you could address a little bit. It's common to talk about the power of prayer. And what rubs me a little bit is the power's in God.
That's right.
Yeah. Not in the act of praying.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if people just don't think that through, but I don't know if I was being extra sensitive to it, but... They're well-meaning people that say that,
well,
talk
yes.
about the power of prayer, but the emphasis in you just need to do it, and that's where it comes from. I don't think that's what they mean, but the scripture doesn't approach it that way.
No, your reservation is justified.
Mm.
They mean well, but see, he doesn't say all things are possible to him that prayeth. Right? He doesn't say that. Prayer is effective because, one, it's driven by faith, and two, it's answered by God. So the power is not in the prayer. I know it's a clumsy expression, and I think it's just because it's been said so much that people repeat it. So it's good for us just to learn to say things precisely, and sensitive people will pick up that is said a bit differently. The glory goes to God.
Amen.
And incidentally, yes, the people who talk about power to prayer don't exhibit. Their prayers don't exhibit that power, almost without exception.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a kind of a phrase.
I've noted the same thing could be said of people who say, I believe in prayer.
I believe in prayer.
Yeah. Well, I believe in God.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's what needs to be said.
Yeah.
And then you'll separate those who believe in prayer from
Amen.
Those who believe in God.
Yeah, well, some people, they just need a little more clarity.
That's right.
It's that. As a matter of fact, we should assume that. When we hear people, we should not assume that
they
know fully what they said. Assume that they need to be clarified. And and with gentleness,
yes,
point out this broader.
Instead of the power of prayer, we could say the power of God.
Yeah, the power of God. Yeah, the prayer is the seeking to appropriate the power.
Yeah,
you could
right.
say it that way.
Yeah.
These are good things to talk about because over the years, Satan has neutralized what we call Christianity by these dumbed-down phrases that people, they take for granted that they're true.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the older ones was God helps them that helps themselves, and people think that that's the truth. So there's ways that we can direct people into a more proper way of thinking. That it's like a half-baked cake. Or like a cake that doesn't have all the ingredients. They cook the cake, but they forgot to put the flour in, So we can throw some more ingredients in the thinking hopper for them to consider. It'll be a favor. People that are honest will appreciate it. They'll be glad to hear it.
Yes.
You remember when Paul was at sea, a vicious storm broke up 14 days. It had been raging for 14 days. They couldn't steer the ship, and it just was a free moving about freely.
Uh-huh.
It emptied everything off the ship that they could, even wheat, food, all the tackling of the ship. And in the midst of it, He says this to 276 souls. Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God. That it shall be unto me, be even as it was told me. That's a Lord, an angel appeared to him and told him. The ship's done for. But you got to stay on board or you won't be saved, because you're going to have to take some of these boards and make your way to shore. Notice he said, I believe God.
Yeah.
See? Uh-huh. That's in the middle of a storm. I believe God. See, this is possible now. You could be right in the middle of a tremendous test, period of adversity. And if you're sensitive enough, you'll be able to say, I believe God. There's nothing that can separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. See, you can be confident.
There's two accounts of stormy sea, both Jonah and this one. And we know in the account of Jonah that these men were praying.
Yeah.
Oh, they prayed, made vows.
That's right. That's right, amen.
And it's likely, we don't know from the record, but it's likely that there were those on Paul's ship who were praying.
Mm. Oh, I wouldn't doubt it, yes.
But Paul was the one who received an answer that was valid.
That's
and that
right.
had power.
And like where he said, they fasted for 14 days, which indicates prayer.
That's right.
He said, now you better take... You better eat something now. You've been fasting too long. Now eat some food because you're going to need some strength to get to shore.
Yeah.
How's that for being in charge of the situation? That was there was a man, there was a man on that ship that God could use.
Amen.
There he was, and God saved those 276 men because of Paul.
Amen.
Isn't that good?
Yeah.
Gave him instructions, so he went his way.
He believed prayer. He said he believed God.
Believed God. Yeah. Amen. In fact, an angel appeared to him. It doesn't say it was an answer to his prayer.
Right.
The angel appeared to him.
Yeah.
I wanted to make mention of the fact that the words faith and believe in its various forms, believe, believed, believing, is mentioned 231 times. In Romans through Jude. 231 times. This tells you that this is a faith is pivotal.
That's right. Amen.
There isn't any kind of teaching that faith is absent from. The integral part of it. All those beginning at Romans through Jude, they're all addressed to churches and Christian people. None of them are addressed to the world.
That's
not
right.
One.
Uh-huh.
They're all addressed to God's family.
Mm-hmm.
So this means once you believe, it's not that that's not like it's all over.
That's right.
Hmm? You need to have words on faith and growth in faith from till the day you die. And he went his way, set out for home. And I know the word is fulfilled in him. He that believes will not be ashamed or disappointed, as some say.
Yes.
So I will tell you, brethren, that you will never be disappointed because you believed God.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. And that happened. Any of you have a word to say? Yes, Brother Aaron.
Similar to what Brother Jim said about things that he's heard, something that bothers me is people downplaying believing.
Mm-hmm.
Saying things like, well, it's not enough to believe. You also have to do this and that. I think it's important to know that the believing and faith is how the Lord has designed the gospel to work.
Mm-hmm.
That's
so
good.
He said,
right.
Blessed are they who have not seen.
Mm-hmm.
Yet
believe.
Have belief, and he arranged it so that the apostles heard that he had risen from the dead before they saw.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That he had risen from
that's
the dead.
That's right.
And that's true of everyone. That kind of set the premise.
Mm-hmm.
And so the testimony or the gospel is a testimony.
Mm-hmm.
It's a report of what has happened.
Mm-hmm.
It's a report of what has been accomplished. And so what can you do with a report? You either believe it or you don't.
That's right.
Amen.
And that, so that's how this is the design.
Amen.
Not, there's nothing in the kingdom that is just because. You know, there are things in the world. Some systems work. This is just the way it is. You,
uh-huh.
know, you don't really get.
See,
you don't
yeah.
really get a reason. But there's a reason. The Lord, like the Lord asked us to trust Him. Well, there's a reason to trust Him because He's good, because He's righteous.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. There's a reason to trust Him, and there's a reason to believe.
Amen. Yeah, you might say everything He does is intentional. Yeah,
that's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's the kind of thinking you were talking about that I had to overcome. It took some time. It was ingrained in my thinking that there was some kind of inferiority in believing. It wasn't quite enough.
Yeah.
Thank God for being delivered from that sort of thinking because it produced more questions than answers.
Right.
Even when I accepted that, I wasn't satisfied with it.
We were talking about intercession earlier. Do you remember now that account you brought up with Paul in the ship? He was recounting what the angel appeared to him and said, and lo, God has given the men that sailed with
to
him.
Yeah,
so
to him.
I thought that was another instance.
Amen.
On behalf of Paul, he gave him the whole, crew.
He became the captain of the ship.
Yeah.
Amen. Anybody else? Yes, Brother Jonathan?
Yeah, at the beginning of your lesson, you spoke about how doubt will cancel out with a request.
Mm-hmm.
And that brings to mind that expression, little faith, that Jesus spoke of. And we know little faith isn't good because you just have to look at when he used it. It's after Peter started singing. That's when he said, little faith. When he mentioned beware the leaven of the Pharisees, he says because we haven't taken bread, says little faith.
Mm-hmm.
That's when he said that. So we shouldn't take mustard seed view that people say was able. See, look at what just a little bit of faith can do when you look at those accounts. Little faith can't do much at all. So
now that's the point of faith is like a mustard seed. Isn't that faith is small? It's that faith grows.
Yeah, that's right.
That's the point. It grows exponentially.
That's right. Right.
Yeah, your faith has grown. You've seen your own faith grow, haven't you? It's because it's the nature of faith. You just had to get in the right soil and have the right fertilizer, and it sprouted and grew.
And, for those who say, well, faith is just like ethereal, it's out there, we don't really... These are real-life experiences.
Right.
Heavy laden, or rest. Which would you rather have?
That's right.
Would you rather be cast down and in despair, or would you rather be trusting and being... lifted up and encouraged and benefited. That's what faith will do for you.
That's right.
And it's a real experience, and you know it if you have it.
Amen.
You know it. Are you cast down? Are you heavy laden over some kind of circumstance? Give it to the Lord, and He'll give you rest.
Yeah.
That's what He'll do.
Think how gloriously simplistic it is. You're heavy laden. That means you got something that is very hard to carry.
Yeah.
So what do? Come to Christ.
Yes, amen.
He'll take it from there.
Yes.
That's how it works,
amen.
Brother Jim.
Amen.
From my educational background, the question or the instruction of Scripture to always be prepared to give an answer for the hope that's in you, the answer to that is apologetics in the background that I come from. In other words, prepare to be able to give an intellectual discourse why
apologetic.
That's the answer to that. But that is contrary to the nature of faith.
Yeah.
Right.
Because
faith has to be seen on a different realm.
Yes.
That's right.
Amen.
Very good.
Can't be understood.
Very
way.
Good.
Amen.
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 And that was like a burden, wasn't it?
Argument's never good enough.
Yeah.
There's always somebody
that's
smarter that can shoot it down. Then you go home with your tail between your legs, and I let the Lord down because I couldn't, explain it well enough.
Uh-huh.
But when you look at it from a different tier, even the most learned of men from a wisdom, they can see something in you that's different. They'll sense it.
Uh-huh. That's right.
And then it will get onto a different plane if they want to pursue it. If not, they'll go somewhere else. But It's the wisdom that comes from above.
That's why they ask the reason for the hope.
That's right.
I was subjected to that from Carter teaching too, but no one emphasized that. Ask a reason for the hope to save you.
Yeah.
That was never emphasized. You know, what their question was, which church do you go to? That's the kind of questions that they were set to answer. Yeah.
His reasoning's on a different level.
That's right.
Amen.
And incidentally, instead of going to church, the church does the going.
Yes. Yeah. Amen.
All right, I think we'll close there, Sister Barbara.